This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Welcome to worship with St. John's. Welcome to you in the sanctuary. Welcome to you online. Welcome, special welcome to guests who are with us on this day. We've come for this hour of worship to rest and rejoice in the saving love of Jesus for you and for me and for the whole world. And coming for worship helps us to be the church all week long. This is week three in our series, Famous Johns. Over 7 weeks, we're meeting some famous Johns as we read through the Gospel of John. In our reading for today, we'll hear how Jesus spoke to a man named Nicodemus at night. Spoke to him about being born from above, being born anew, and of God's saving love for the whole world. This is our annual Bluegrass Worship Service, so a special thanks to our praise team and a special encouragement to you to clap your hands and tap your toes and praise the Lord with your heart and your body and your mind and your soul this morning. We were to have a concert last night with Soggy Prairie that has been postponed for an illness in the band, as such are the times, so look forward in the next month or so for that to be rescheduled. If you have a ticket for that, you can hang on to it and wait to see when the new date is, or at any time you can get a refund for your ticket as well. It's not a fundraiser, it's just to cover our costs. So hopefully we'll hear next 4 to 6 weeks we'll have a new date yet this winter. After worship, you're invited to a time of refreshments and fellowship, and then we'll connect over basic learning hour for our children. A few announcements in our life together, things that are coming up next Saturday morning. We'll be hiking at Magnolia Bluff. This ministry continues a couple times a month, and a great way to connect with one another outside. Meet at 9 a.m. at the church parking lot, and we'll head over to Magnolia Bluff. Next Saturday evening, we'll have a brief service of healing following our Saturday service, right about 6 o'clock, and we'll lay hands on one another and anoint each other with oil and pray for healing in our lives. So join us for that as you'd like to. Our annual meeting is next Sunday, January 30th. We'll meet right after worship. We'll also meet on YouTube and Zoom and here in the sanctuary. We'll reflect on 2021. We'll look ahead to 2022, the annual report, the detailed budget, and a response card. They're all available for you on the welcome desk, so be sure to grab your annual meeting materials. That response card can be turned in at any time so that we can be well prepared for our annual meeting and not have any surprises, and so it can be a really positive experience. So hope you make use of those. Also, our fundraiser brunch will be after our annual meeting. Hope you can join us for that. Kids Against Hunger will be packaging meals on February 6th, that Sunday. Sign-ups for that are on the ministry table. We'll have a special offering next week to help cover the cost of 25,000 meals that we're going to package, which is pretty great. We're making progress on our 22 household challenge for Simply Giving. Simply Giving is our electronic funds transfer that offers consistent generosity for the giver, consistent income for the congregation's ministries. We've got 13 out of 22 new or increases in Simply Giving. Maybe that's the right next step for you in your journey toward generosity. Forms are on the wall display, and also you can go online to do that. In other generosity news, our new goal in our scholarship challenge match is $100,000, and we're at $84,000. So we're doing well. We have till the end of the month. Perhaps you'll consider a gift of $1,000 or $500 or even $100 toward helping us reach that goal of $100,000 and then launching that endowment with $250,000. That'll be pretty great when we make that goal. The Blue Epistle, our website, email news, has other announcements and events and prayers to connect you into our life together, so take a look there. We will celebrate Holy Communion together this morning. If you're joining us online, you are also welcome to celebrate Holy Communion with us. Just have a form of bread and wine or juice available. Those here in the sanctuary, come forward with your hand open to receive the bread and then the cup of wine or juice before continuing back to your seat. An empty basket at the end of the front row is for your empty cup. All are welcome to participate in that holy meal. If you would rather, come forward and cross your arms to receive a blessing. We'll have a prayer leader available in the gathering area if you'd like to pray with someone one-on-one during Holy Communion. I invite you to please rise for a time of confession. We gather in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, Jesus shows us all the ways that we fall short. He also provides a way out of the holes we dig ourselves into. Forgive us our sins and show us how to make better choices and to be better friends, parents, kids, partners, and co-workers. Let Christ's light shine through us. For the sake of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Jesus does indeed forgive. Jesus cleanses us of our sin and recreates us in God's image. Receive the entire forgiveness of all your sins. Go and walk free of guilt, shame, and sin. You are made new in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing, I Saw the Light.
I wandered so aimless, I feel the sin.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We read together from Psalm 95. O come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving.
And raise a loud shout to the Lord with psalms.
For you, Lord, are a great God.
And a great ruler above all gods.
In your hand are the caverns of the earth.
The heights of the hills are also yours.
The sea is yours, for you have made it.
And your hands have molded the dry land.
Come, let us worship and bow down.
Let us kneel before the Lord, our maker.
For the Lord is our God, and we are the people of God's pasture.
We are the sheep of God's hand.
Let us join together in prayer. O God, rich in mercy. By the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world and rescued us from the hopelessness of death. Lead us into your light, that all our deeds may reflect your love, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
I invite you to please be seated as we continue with our mission and ministry moment. Celebration of a milestone for our first graders. Hundreds of years before Jesus was born, God gave us the Ten Commandments through his servant Moses on Mount Sinai. Now, the Old Testament has a total of 613 commandments. The Ten Commandments are a summary of God's law for us. So let's name the Ten Commandments. Don't worry, it's not a pop quiz. You don't have to do it by memory. We're going to put them on the board using updated language. This is the language that our first graders will see today. Let's read them together. Number one, we put God first. Number two, we use God's name to pray, praise, and give thanks. Number three, we take a day to rest and worship together. Number four, we honor, love, and respect our parents. Number five, we don't hurt each other. Number six, we are loyal. Number seven, we don't take what's not ours. Number eight, we tell the truth and speak well of others. Number nine, we are grateful for our belongings. Number 10, we are grateful for our family. We love and trust God. Now, the Ten Commandments are not meant to discourage us or to steal our fun. They are a gift from God to guide us in living a good life with God, with others, and with ourselves in thought, word, and deed. The first three commandments focus on our relationship with God. The next five commandments focus on our relationships with one another. And the last two commandments govern our private thoughts. Well, in a special workshop today, we'll welcome our first graders to explore the Ten Commandments and to consider God's good laws for our lives. As I call your name, first graders, if you're here, come on forward for a special gift. Lara Church, Bowden Cook, Hudson Goals, Braden Hoff, Owen Krajak, come on up. Aaron Qualheim, Caleb Qualheim, Cashton Phillips, Avery Putnam, Megan Richards, Wesley Rinneker, Delaney Spike, Ethan Sperry, Madeline Westby, Jacob Wilson. Any other first graders I didn't call? Okay, good. Well, this is the gift that we have for you. It's a wall hanging of the Ten Commandments in that updated language that we use. We invite you to put it up on your wall, like in your room, to help you live in God's ways. And for now, let's say a prayer for these young disciples. I invite you to extend a hand as we pray for them. God, we thank you for the gift of the Ten Commandments and for your guidance in our lives. Bless these young disciples as they walk in your ways. Help them and all of us to love you and to love others in our thoughts, words, and deeds. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Join me in thanking God for these young people. And you guys can go back to your seat. Thank you.
What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him.
Our scripture reading for today is from the Gospel of John, the story of Nicodemus visiting Jesus. Let's review Jesus' activity up to this point in the Gospel of John. Jesus was baptized by John in the Jordan River, and he began to gather followers. After that, Jesus turned water into wine at a wedding, a sign of his transforming power. A few days after that, as we heard last week, Jesus caused a public stir during Passover over the sinful systems of oppression and corruption at the temple. Jesus set the cattle and the sheep and the doves free as a sign that he would set us free from the power of sin. During the Passover festival, Jesus stayed in Jerusalem to teach and perform signs. Many believed in his name as a result. And many more were curious, including a man named Nicodemus. This brings us to our reading today, picking up exactly where we left off last week. While Jesus was still in Jerusalem, a man named Nicodemus visited him at night. Nicodemus was a Pharisee, so he was a devout religious man. He came at night to avoid public scrutiny and pressure. He wanted to hear about Jesus for himself. Nicodemus started the conversation with a compliment, acknowledging that he knew Jesus came from God. And then Jesus taught Nicodemus about the Spirit and about spiritual birth, being born from above, being born anew. But Nicodemus was taking everything so literally. He wasn't understanding what Jesus was saying. He was very much in the dark. Jesus went on to talk about God's love, about condemnation and salvation. He spoke about the human tendency to hide our sin, and he talked about the light of God. We don't find out how Jesus' teachings affected Nicodemus until later in the gospel story, but they did have an effect on him, and they have an effect on us today. Our readers can come forward. And I invite you to turn to this story with us in your Bibles so we can receive God's word in our ears and with our eyes. We'll hear from the narrator, from Nicodemus, and from Jesus. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 3rd chapter. Glory to you, O Lord.
Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him,
Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God.
Jesus answered him,
very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above.
Nicodemus said to him,
how can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?
Jesus answered,
very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh. What is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I say to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit.
Nicodemus said to him,
how can these things be?
Jesus answered him,
are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you don't understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I've told you about earthly things and you don't believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Famous Johns, this is week 3 in our series of Famous Johns. We're exploring people and places that bear the name John in one form or another as we read through the Gospel of John to better know Jesus Christ. Week 1, we considered the historic St. John's Church building of Evansville. to celebrate the transforming power of Jesus Christ in our lives. Week number two, last week, we considered the French hero and saint Joan of Arc to proclaim our freedom from sin, death, and the devil through Jesus Christ. This week, our famous John is the British cleric John Newton, who lived from 1725 to 1807. John Newton served as a pastor in the Anglican Church for over 40 years, and he was well-loved and respected across the Christian churches in England. His preaching was renowned, and people flocked to hear him. But John Newton wasn't always a pastor, or a Christian, or even an honorable man. John Newton's mother, Elizabeth, nurtured him in the words of the Bible from an early age, but she died of tuberculosis when he was 7 years old, and John was sent to a boarding school. At the age of 11, John went to sea with his father, who was a merchant navy captain. John Newton's behavior became wretched in this environment. He developed a pattern of unsettled behavior and impatience of restraint that would persist for many years. In other words, he was impulsive and unpredictable. He was described as arrogant and insubordinate. He had very little moral compass. He was fired from jobs. He rebelled against the Royal Navy. He was caught and jailed and flogged and publicly disgraced. Later, he wrote that during this time in his life, he sinned with a high hand. He wrote, "I made it my study to tempt and seduce others." In his own words, he was a wretch for many years. He struggled with both murderous and suicidal thoughts. John Newton ended up working as a slave in Africa when his own crew sold him off. There he was abused and mistreated and nearly starved to death. He had to beg for food. Eventually, he got on a ship headed back to England in 1748 at the age of 23. On the voyage home, the ship was overtaken by an enormous storm. The experience of near death shook him, and he turned to God, to the foundation of faith that had been laid in him by his mother Elizabeth. John Newton prayed for God to save him and vowed to give his life to Christ. After his prayer, the storm died down. Newton and the crew survived. And John was true on his word. He began to read the Bible, and he renounced profanity, gambling, and drinking. It was a powerful and life-changing experience for Newton. Still, his life as a follower of Christ was just beginning. He later wrote, "I am not what I ought to be. I am not what I want to be. I am not what I hope to be. But still, I am not what I used to be. And by the grace of God, I am what I am." This was a big step on his journey of being born from above, born anew. John Newton continued to live life on the seas as a mate and then as a captain for a number of slave ships. He was hoping as a Christian to restrain the worst excesses of the slave trade. He intended to share God's word with both his crew and the Africans on board. Because of a stroke at the age of 29, John Newton left life on the seas. Newton got married, took an office job with the fleet, adopted two orphaned nieces, and began leading Bible studies in his home. He engaged in serious religious study and learned Greek and Hebrew. He became increasingly disgusted with the African slave trade and with his role in it. He applied to be a minister in the Church of England. It took more than 7 years for him to be accepted. His first post in 1764 was at Olney in Buckinghamshire, and his second and final post until his death was at St. Mary Woolnoth in London. Newton became an abolitionist and encouraged members of Parliament, including William Wilberforce, to end the African slave trade, which he lived to see just months before his death. During Newton's years as a parish pastor, he wrote many hymns, some of which are still very popular today. Five of his hymn texts appear in our hymnal, the ELW, Hymnal in Your Pew. In 1982, John Newton was inducted into the Gospel Music Hall of Fame. His hymns include Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds, and one other about his own life that many of us know very well, Amazing Grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. John Newton was a wretch who experienced the saving love of Jesus. John Newton was lost, but he was found by the saving love of Jesus. John Newton was blind, but he gained his sight and embraced the saving love of Jesus. Perhaps Nicodemus from our scripture reading today is a bit like John Newton. Was Nicodemus a wretch? That's probably a stretch. He was a Pharisee, a religious man, which means he lived by a strict moral code, though he was probably self-righteous and arrogant. He was at least curious enough to come to Jesus, though under the cover of night. He was lost and searching. He was yearning for love and grace, yet he was blind to the movement of the Spirit. That night, Nicodemus encountered the saving love of Jesus firsthand, and it changed him. We hear about the change later in John's gospel. Later, as recorded in chapter 7, Nicodemus stood up for Jesus and tried to send others to Jesus. When the religious leaders were eager to condemn Jesus, it was Nicodemus who advocated for them to go and hear Jesus for themselves and investigate Jesus before passing judgment. And after Jesus' death on the cross, as recorded in John chapter 20, it was Nicodemus who joined Joseph of Arimathea to bury Jesus' body. Nicodemus brought 100 pounds of aloe and myrrh, which exceeded all normal preparations. It was enough for a royal burial. Nicodemus had encountered the saving love of Jesus, and it changed him too. He too was once lost, but now was found in the saving love of Jesus. He too was once blind, but came to see and embrace the saving love of Jesus. Oh, the saving love of Jesus. It heals the souls of the wretches. It finds the lost. It gives sight to the blind. Do you know the saving love of Jesus? Are you trusting the saving love of Jesus? You can. We can. The love of Jesus saves us from being lost. It saves us from being blind. The love of Jesus saves us from our past, from our mistakes, from our wretched sins. The love of Jesus saves us from loneliness. It saves us from fear. It saves us from death. We can trust the love of Jesus. We can trust the love of God. We can surrender to the love of God. We can rest in the love of God. You see, God is not mad at us. God is not mad at you. God is not mean to us. God is not mean to you. God's disposition to you and to me and to the whole world is love. God even loves the parts of this world that do not know God or love God. As we hear from John 3, 16 and 17, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. God did not send Jesus into the world to condemn the world. That's not the mission of Jesus. That's not the way of Jesus. That's the way of humankind. We do that to ourselves. We do that to one another. We condemn ourselves. We condemn one another. That's not God's objective. God did not send Jesus into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. To save you and me and every human being and all of creation. Oh, the saving love of Jesus. There's nothing for you and me to do. It's all been done for us by God through Jesus Christ, who came to this earth to love us and forgive us, who died on the cross to love us and forgive us, who rose from the dead to love us and forgive us, who comes to us still today and every day to love us and forgive us and to find us and to give us sight and to give us new birth from above. There's nothing for you and me to do. It's all been done for us by Jesus, and that's grace. That's amazing grace. And now, having received God's grace, having been claimed by God and been born from above, we believe in Jesus. We trust Jesus. We trust his amazing grace. We put our faith in God. We rest in God's love. And we live for God every day. Every day we are born from above, born anew to God, every day. John Newton was born from above on that day at sea, and he continued to be born from above and give his life to God. Nicodemus was born from above that night long ago and continued to be born from above and give his life to God. Our own Martin Luther taught that through our baptism, we are born from above, and then we die to sin every day and rise to share the new life in Christ. Daily dying, daily rising, daily born anew. We are baptized once and for all time into Jesus Christ, and we are born from above, born anew every day thereafter. Every day we commit our lives to the one who gave his life for us. Every day we trust in God's amazing grace because it's the way to true life. Every day we tell the story of Jesus and his saving love for all. We tell the story because we need to hear it again and again. We tell the story to those who know it best because they hunger for it too. We tell the story to those who've never heard it. And there are so many who have never heard it and who yearn for the love that only God can give. You and I probably won't ever be famous like John the Baptist or John the Gospel writer or even like John Newton. But you are known and loved by God, by Jesus Christ. And you and I can share the story of Jesus and his love with anyone and everyone we meet. Oh, the saving love of Jesus for you, for me, for the whole world, for today, forever. Amen. Our song of the day is, I Love to Tell the Story. I invite you to rise and sing together.
Living together in trust and hope, let us now confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We invite you to be seated for a time of prayer. Together we'll pray for the church, the world, and all those in need according to our prayer request. For whom and for what shall we pray together today? The blessing of grandchildren. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your saving love in Jesus Christ, and we lift up to you grandchildren. We thank you for the blessing that they are in so many people's lives, and we pray that you would empower grandparents to share your love with their grandchildren. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Go Yes, those who knew God and have wandered away from God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your saving love for us in Jesus Christ, and we lift up to you those who have wandered away from your love and your caring embrace. God, we pray that you would help to guide their path, bring them home to you, that they may once again rest and rejoice in your saving love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For musicians and composers, let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your love for us through Jesus Christ, and we lift up to you musicians and composers. We thank you for the ways that they allow us to sing your praises and know your love. We pray that you would continue to empower musicians, strengthen them, that they may continue to lead us in praise. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Those recovering from COVID, let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your saving love for us through Jesus Christ, and we lift up to you all those who are recovering from COVID, all those who are ill or injured or hospitalized. We pray, God, that your healing love and your healing power would come to them. Strengthen doctors, nurses, and medical teams. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we'll end with our prayer commitments.
Merciful God, we ask you for healing in body, mind, and soul, in whatever ways you know that we need. We especially lift up to you these friends of our church: Jean, Amber, Nancy, Jean, Sue, Brenda, Jody, Jean, Chuck, Archer, Jack, Jennifer, and Dennis. Help us to care for one another with compassion and open hands. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the children in our midst, especially those in elementary, intermediate, and middle school. We pray that as they grow, they will hear your voice calling them into your service, in the church, in the world, for the sake of their neighbors. Help them to imagine being pastors and deacons, church council leaders, Sunday school teachers, mentors, and community leaders. Give them courage to say yes to your call. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray now in silence for those who do not know your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
It's time for the children's message. My young friends, you're invited to come on up. Let's meet together. If you've got a noisy offering, you can bring that too. Come on up, drop it in the bucket. Let's meet together. All right. Oh, I'm glad you're here today. I want to tell you about a kid named Dusty. He was in my class when I was a kid in school, and Dusty was very mean to me. Has anyone ever been mean to you? Yeah, it sometimes happens sometimes. Well, this guy, Dusty, he would call me names, and he made fun of me, and he pushed me around, and it was really rough. Some days I didn't even want to go to school because I knew Dusty would be there and that he was going to be mean to me. But even though Dusty wasn't nice to me, I knew that there were a lot of people who loved me. My family loved me and my friends, and I knew that God loved me. But do you think that God loved Dusty? Yeah, God even loved Dusty. I'm not sure if Dusty knew it, but God loves even people who are mean. God loves us when we do good things, and God loves us even when we do bad things. God loves us all the time. That's how strong God's love is. There is nothing stronger, nothing bigger than God's love. And God loves you and me and everyone out there, and even people who are mean and even people who don't know it. And so part of our mission, part of our job in life, is to help people know that wonderful love of God. Nothing is bigger or stronger than the love of Jesus. God's love is so big. Well, thanks, friends, for coming up. Will you help me share the peace of the Lord? Stand up and put your arms out wide and say it with me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to turn and share a sign of peace with your neighbor. Thanks for coming up. Peace be with you. We invite you to give an offering to the Mission Ministry of St. John's. You can do that online, the drop box on the front porch, by mail, and the offering boxes are at the entrances to the sanctuary. Last week, a woman came up to me after worship, and she said, I'd had a really rough week, and I almost didn't come tonight, but I'm so glad I did. Worship was just what I needed to help me get through the next week. And I hope and pray that that can be true for you, that worship lifts you up and gives you strength for the days ahead. We'll now receive a gift of music.
I'm only human. I'm just a person.
Yeah.
In thanksgiving for the gift of our lives, our offering shared, and the meal we are about to receive, let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The table is set. Christ is the host. Come as you are. Please be seated. For you worshiping online, the body of Christ is given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you.
Oh, got peace like a river.
Please rise as you're able. And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace.
Amen.
Amen. Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need. And to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you and who calls you by name, bless your going out and your coming in today and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Let's fly away.
I'll fly away, oh, away, oh, away. I'll
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.